Okay, hey, welcome back here from our 20-minute break here, and on to lecture number 2 of day 14, and this is also the end of week number 5, and so I'll say it again, this is a big weekend coming up where you really should put in a lot of time and do anything and everything, even work ahead. I said in the last lecture, review all your stuff so that you're ready for the final and you only have the new stuff to do next week, and that's true, but you can even work ahead a little bit if you think you're going to be overwhelmed. And it also dawned on me over the break that maybe another obligation you might have is on Sunday. Sunday is Father's Day here, so of course work that into your schedule. That's an important day too, but work towards studying and getting ready for test number 3 and then the final exam. As I was saying when we went over the calculations here, once I get your grade posted tomorrow, you can average your first and your second one and figure out where you are, knowing that the third test and the final are about the same, even a little bit more than those two. And so you can, anticipate, hey, I'm going to study hard so my grade goes up, or I hope you don't plan on your grade going down, but I guess you could. But don't plan on your grade going up, and so work towards that. So let's go ahead and start chapter 17 here. As I've been saying many times here, chapter 17 is still on waves, but it's on light waves. And so we leave the mechanical waves and we start to look at the properties of light. And the properties of light are interesting, very, very interesting. So there's a lot to talk about besides just the wave properties that we've already learned. And so don't forget that great stuff about the wave properties we learned in 15, and then we carried it into 16 for sound. But we'll also carry that into the wave properties of light. But there's some other things here. And the first step here is kind of simple. Imagine I have a light bulb, and so I'll set a light bulb up here in a second. And so maybe I have a kind of an old-fashioned incandescent light bulb where I have a filaments and some electrical wires, and I turn on the light, and you know what happens is the light comes outward. We might say these are light rays. I hooked one up here so you could see it. It's not real fancy. Here is the old-fashioned incandescent light bulb. Here is my control meter. This one's nice because I could turn it to really bright or not. This is a really bright bulb, so I'll keep it kind of on the low side. Even that's really bright. Probably saturating the camera there on the white balance there. But what I wanted to do, and maybe I'll just, because my eyes are getting blinded here, is turn it down a little bit and just say, all right, now what is happening here is the light is coming towards me, and what I want to convince you of is something that you probably already know. It's not too unreasonable, although it is very different than the early scientists in the Greek times. And this is just a simple question of how do you see the light and how do you see an image? And one of the things I want to get across to you here at the beginning is the light comes towards us through the air in a straight line. That's why we're going to call these light rays. Now, sometimes we'll be worried about the light waves, and we'll talk about the wave properties. Remember I said we just got done talking a lot about waves, and so we're still going to have that, but right now I'm not talking about waves, I'm talking about rays. And so the light rays, so if I were to stand back over here and I look over here, I don't see the light bulb. I don't see the light because the light comes straight. It's got to enter my eyes. If it doesn't enter my eyes, I don't see it. And so the light actually leaves the source and comes to the observer. That's me, I'm the observer. Or the camera lens is the observer. And so the light comes down from the overhead lights, hits my body, reflects off my body, and goes to the camera. And so other than the reflection, it travels in a straight line from the light to my body, then reflects off of me and to you. And so that's where we begin, just this whole idea that light travels in a straight line, except, of course, when it reflects. And you see it because it goes to your eyes. Believe it or not, the ancient Greeks had a very different philosophy of the science. They thought things in your eyes came out, explored the world. It was kind of an extension of how you would explore the world with your hands and feel the shapes and then send that information back to your eyes. And that's not how the light works. It's got to actually come to your eyes. That's why if I were to put something in front of it, you know, that blocks it. It doesn't get to your eyes. It travels in a straight line. And to be quite honest, I think in today's world, that's common knowledge, that the light actually is leaving the source and going to our eyes. I'll show you a couple of other ones. Here's a fun one to do. Nothing real fancy here. It's just kind of a little simple laser beam that's a little hard to see. Excuse me, when the chalkboard lights are on, so I'll turn it off. But the little laser beam comes out of here, and it actually is spreading a little bit as it travels across the surface of this whiteboard, and then hits the whiteboard and reflects off going to you. And so you see this long red strip, but rest assured, you don't see the part that's going across. So watch. If I were to take this red laser beam, this one, and put it right here and push the button, you won't see anything different. I'll point it on the wall here or on the whiteboard. See, the light is going to the whiteboard. You don't see it until it reflects off and goes to the camera. Or your eyes if this was a face-to-face class. So the light is traveling here. Is there something right here? Is there light? Yeah, and you can see it when I put my hand in front of it. All right, that little flash is as it's reflecting off my hand and going towards you. And so if I hold it in front of me and turn it on, it just goes across right here. You don't see it. You don't see it until it reflects. And so it's got to go to your eyes. Your eyes are how you see it. And so again, I just want to emphasize those two steps. Maybe they're obvious. Light travels in a straight line, and it goes to your eyes. To help see the straight line and to your eyes, it's kind of fun to do this. This is just kind of some spray smoke. And so if I spray it into the air, it just makes a kind of a little mist in the air. It gives something for the light to reflect off. So if I shine the laser beam over here on the door, and again, right now, you don't see anything. But I want to emphasize, there is light beams right here, or light rays going across. And if I put a little smoke in the air, and then spray it, you could see it. In fact, maybe it looks nicer in a dark room. And so here's the laser beam in red, going across. So again, I hope you're seeing that, yeah, it is a nice straight line. In fact, let's see if I can even see in the dark. I have another one here. What color is this one? The green one. I'll do the same thing. There's still some smoke in the air, but I'll add a little bit more. And so there's the smoke. And again, hopefully you can see it's a straight line. And of course, you don't see it till there's a little bit of smoke in the air, a little bit of particles, so it can kind of bounce off there. And so there's my laser beam. I have a third one over here. It's getting all smoky up here. Maybe you're glad you're not face to face right now. Here's a violet one. It's kind of even hard to see with my eyes. I wonder how well it picks up on the video camera here. But nonetheless, I'll spray that. And so again, it doesn't matter what color it is, they all go in a straight line, and they all then need to reflect off in order for you to see it. And that's what I'm trying to emphasize here, that there is these things which we're going to call rays or beams of light. And so the light has to go to your eyes. Now, there's two other nice extensions on this. The first one is, well, why did we see different colors? You know, what's white? What's, I had a red, a green, and a violet up here. And those are actually the different frequencies. And your book talks about it a little bit later. And plus, I want some sunshine. So I'm going to hold off for about 45 minutes and talk more about the color when I get there. But let's talk about the other part of this, not just the color, but then how do I get from the light what we might call our depth perception, what we might say where it is. For example, how do I know the camera is over here? As I stand here, I know my camera is over here to my right, and the computer is, well, if I stand this way, straight in front of me, and the whiteboard is to my left, and the whiteboard is closer to me than the video camera and the computer. But over here, my calculator is closer than all that other equipment, like the wave machine that is over there on that table. And so, moving with this discussion, we call this a binocular vision. Maybe if I were drawing something, let me turn this laser off here for a moment. But if I had, say, a tree that I was looking at, and so maybe there's a tree in the park, I could be standing close to the tree looking at it, or I could be far away looking at it. And how do I know then where that tree is? How do I know if the tree is close versus the tree is far? And this is what is referred to as binocular vision. And with binocular vision, you need those two eyes. Essentially, your left eye comes and looks at a slightly different angle than your right eye. And it's those difference in angle that allow you to determine, is it close or is it far away? Watch, if I were looking, let's say there is a bird nesting up in the top of the tree. And somebody who is close would then see the light coming from the bird, and there would be an angle between the light going to the person's left eye and the person's right eye. The same thing for somebody further away. The light from the bird would go into the right eye, and the light from the bird would go into the left eye. But there would be a different angle associated with that. Your brain can pick that up. The further something gets away, that smaller that angle is. Or put it another way, it almost looks identical in the left eye and the right eye. Things are so far away that you're not really seeing them. Like when I stand here, and you can't see it on camera, but there's a pole right here. And so when I look at that pole, this eye kind of sees a little bit on that side of the pole, and this eye sees a little bit on that side of the pole. So this eye doesn't see exactly the same as this eye. I can even close this eye, and if I'll close my left one, my right eye can see a little bit over here that when I close my right eye, I can't see it with my left eye. And so it's that difference in the image that gives you this depth perception. Oh, we call this a binocular vision or a stereoscopic view of something. And it takes those two eyes. Now, don't get me wrong. There are other little subtleties for give me depth perception. For example, when I stand up here, and you probably can't see it on camera, but how do I know this desk is in front of that chair? Well, I know that in part because the desk overlaps the chair. And so we call that overlap. And overlap can give you the perception of depth also. Size also comes into play. If I see a car, which I know is usually a big object, but it's in a drawing or a painting and it's kind of small, that gives me the perception that it's far away. So size and overlap come into play. I get that. But the angle between them, that's why, like on a TV screen, it is not as clearly depth perception as the real world. I mean, you know when you're looking at a movie screen, and you know when you're looking at a TV or a computer screen. You also know that there's some depth perception, and so you watch a movie, you can tell which actor is closer and further, but it is not the same as if you turn away from your TV screen and you see your friend and then your other friend, and they're, you know, a different distance. I mean, it's just very, very clear. You have that binocular vision, that stereoscopic vision. Now, I bring all this up because we're going to try to trick the eye, if you will. We're going to then take an image of something. We're going to look in a mirror. We're going to look through a lens. And we're going to say, what do we see? And then to answer what do we see and why we see it, we really have to understand how our eyes work. And so we're going to build up to that. And so knowing it needs both eyes and the angle of that is what determines where the light is coming from. And so, again, as silly as it may be, if I just stood here, I would look at the light diverging from the top of this faucet and notice that it spreads out differently at a different angle than the light, say, from my calculator, which is a little further away. And so it is that spread of the light. It is the association of two rays of light, where they are coming from. They originate at the same point, and so my brain knows that. And so I can use my binocular vision to kind of project back to say, where is that? And that, as simple as it sounds, is going to be the key to understanding mirrors and lenses. Once we get into some more complicated ones, is we need to really understand how our brain is using binocular vision in order to understand how this whole thing works. So that's why I and the author want to begin with just saying, hey, this is how we see the world. The light comes to us, it goes into our eyes, it travels in a straight line, except when it reflects or refracts, as we'll talk about in the next chapter. And so how could we trick the eye, or how could we make a reflection look three-dimensional? Oh, by the way, it kind of reminds me of the three-dimensional movies. You know, it's actually been a long time since I've been to a movie because of the whole coronavirus thing. We're not allowed to go to movies. But the 3D movies, I really like them, although I find myself not paying much attention to the movie itself because I'm fascinated with how they're built. But if you ever get a chance at a 3D movie, take off your glasses, and what you'll see is what looks like an unfocused image on there. It's really two images. And the lenses in the fancy glasses are allowing one image to go into your left eye and the other one to go into your right eye. And you're seeing something slightly different in each eye. And so it's giving it that same effect of the binocular vision. The light is actually all coming from on the screen, but what your left eye sees is a little different than your right eye, just kind of like me looking at this pole, just because my left eye is over here and my right eye is over here, they see a little bit different of that pole. And so I get that into my brain. And so if my brain sees something a little different on the left than the right, I conclude where it is. In fact, the more different it is, the closer I am, right? You can imagine a pole really close. I'll take my water bottle here. But when this thing's really close, this eye sees this half of it, and this eye sees this half of it. That's a very different sets of halves. And the further this gets away, the more the two images in my left and right eye are the same. So I bring all this up, and your author does too, because to really understand mirrors and the images that are formed in mirrors, and then the next chapter, lenses, and the images that are formed in them, you really have to understand how your brain is processing the light in order to make an image. So I'll come back to that, and that's where these rays will come in, and that's why I was saying earlier, that's where geometry will come into play, and that's where I said that, hey, I probably need to take some time here to help you with some geometry, because your author kind of leaves you hanging. He says, oh, just do some geometry and you're done, and it's not that easy, and so I want to go a little further in this chapter than your author did, and I think we'll have the time for that. So with that in mind, your author starts off with the first law of geometric optics. We call it the law of reflection. And there's two of them. One is called the law of reflection, and the other one is called the law of refraction, and then your author breaks it down into two different chapters here. And so let's just talk about reflections. How does the light behave when it reflects? And so if I had maybe a mirror laying flat on the ground, and I draw a line perpendicular to it. Let me pause right there, because I'm going to use a fancy word from your math class. It's kind of on the advanced math class, so you may not have been exposed to it. But what do we call in geometry something that is perpendicular to a surface? Maybe an example might be this recorder over here. And if I put it on the table like this, let's see if it'll balance and stay. I would say that recorder is perpendicular to the table surface. I could put the recorder here on the side, and again, it's perpendicular to the surface. And if you don't already know, let me tell you that the math word for that is called a normal. So we're going to use that a lot. So a line perpendicular to a surface is a normal. Of course, this is a mirror. It's kind of hard to draw a surface on a mirror, but here's my flat mirror. And so let me take a ray of light. And so in comes a ray of light. It hits the mirror and bounces off. What direction does it go? This is referred to as the law of reflection. And probably the best thing I can do is actually show you a beam of light and a mirror. And so that's why I have this beam again. And I'll turn down the chalkboard light so you can kind of see it here. So here's this red laser beam. And I happen to have, and see if you can see this on camera, but I've got a little shiny surface here. This is going to be the mirror. It's not a very big mirror, but it's got a little magnet on it, so it'll stick to the whiteboard. Okay, and so I'll stick this part on the whiteboard, and I'll put this in the line of the red laser beam. And so taking this and placing it right there, I have something that looks kind of like this drawing over here, where I have a beam coming in, and if I label the normal, okay, so let me draw a line perpendicular to the surface. Okay, so there's the normal. And so here's the red beam coming in. I'll put a little arrowhead saying, okay, here it is coming in. Hits the mirror and heads outward. So there's the reflection. The law of reflection is just simply this statement. Where does the reflected beam go? And I'm hoping you can kind of see in this picture here, doesn't this angle here look to be about the same as that angle there? And that is referred to as the law of reflection. If we call this the incident angle, so I'll call it theta sub I, and then if we call this then the reflected angle, let me call it theta sub F, those two are equal. And so over here on the board, I will say the law of reflection is probably one of the simplest laws of physics there is. I mean, this is not nearly as hard as, say, Newton's three laws of motion or Newton's universal law of gravity. This is just the law of reflection. And it simply just says that we know where the reflected beam is going to go. The reflected beam is going to have the same angle as the incidented beam. Now, I should pause here and point out, notice that the definition then of the incidented beam is between the beam and the normal, not the beam and the mirror. Obviously, it could be defined either way, but there's an advantage of defining it from the normal. And so that's why I introduced you to the normal and the perpendicular. And so I just want to point out a very common student mistake made by the beginning student is right here. They go, oh, this is the incident angle. And no, that is not. And this is the reflected angle. And again, notice it's from the beam and the normal. And so our angles are measured between the beam and the normal, not the beam and the mirror. Okay, the beam and the normal. Now, I know some of you might be thinking ahead and said, well, okay, but wouldn't that mean after I did a little geometry that that angle has to equal that angle? Because if those are equal, and then these have to be 90 degrees, then these have to be equal. And that is true. But as you'll see in the next chapter, when we get into the law of refraction, something a little more interesting happens, and it makes more sense to define it from the normal. And so to be consistent, we always want to go from the normal. So I'll say it again. Notice that the angles are measured from the normal. Both the incident and the reflected angle are measured from the normal. They're from the beam to the normal. All right, so coming back over to here, and then maybe I'll do something like this, just so you can see it again. Let me maybe take this one away, and I will move the mirror maybe a little closer. A little further, so it's at some other location. And maybe I'll change colors, so maybe it will be stand out a little bit better. But watch this. If I draw the normal, and so remember, the normal is perpendicular to the surface. Okay, so here's my normal, so I'll draw a green dotted line right there. And so right here would be the incident angle, right? Because here's the beam coming in. So it's between the beam coming in and the normal. That's the incident. And then this is the reflected. And so the angle of incidence equals the angle of reflection. Maybe I should put two little marks there. So that way when I kind of pull this away, the two little marks here give me a chance to draw. That's where the ray went. So it came in, bounced off, incident equals reflected. If you change the incident, you change the reflected, and that's what's going on here. The beam would start, I'm going to do that in green, start here and head off that way. And so the incident angle equals the reflected angle. And believe it or not, this whole chapter is really centered around that simple law. And so I guess the good news here is the law of reflection is the simple one. So let's just go back to what I showed you earlier. I had this green laser beam, and I was shining it, and I was trying to say that there is light right here. You may not be able to see it because it's not going to your eyes. It's got to reflect off of something. So that's why when I hit the whiteboard, it has to go to the camera. It has to go to your eyes. But even though this isn't a face-to-face setting, I'm sure you would be convinced that even though you can't see the light as it heads towards the whiteboard, every student, the students on my left and the students on my right and the students in the front and the students in the back, can all see this beam as it hits the whiteboard. How could it just go from here off to there? Well, let me grab a reflecting surface here. And so I have a little handheld mirror here, although I got a bunch of ones. Let me make sure I find a flat one here. If I shoot the laser beam onto the mirror, is it going to get brighter or is it going to get dimmer? So I'm going to come down. Did it get brighter or get dimmer? Is the mirror more reflective than the whiteboard, or is the whiteboard more reflective? Doesn't it kind of look like it got dimmer when it hit the mirror? And what I'm trying to point out is the whole reason everybody can see it when it hits the whiteboard is on a small level, very small level. If we compare the reflection off of the mirror with the reflection off the whiteboard, we do have something very different. The whiteboard is actually not very smooth. Now they have a smooth coat on it, so when I wipe my hand on it, it feels nice and smooth. But underneath that smooth, clear coat is a very curvy, bumpy surface. Because here's the idea, that if you shine a laser beam onto the mirror, the law of reflection does make it go in a particular direction, and that particular direction is not towards the camera. It's not towards your eyes. As I was holding it here, it would bounce off and it was hitting that far wall. Now, if you were over here on this far wall, you would have bounced off that mirror and it would have gone right into your eyes. You go, oh, you would have gone, whoa, yeah, that is very reflective. But for most of you, and in this case, all of you, none of you are in this direction. And so what ends up happening, you're standing, say, here. And when it hits the mirror and it goes off that direction, very little, if any of it, actually goes to your eyes. Now, my mirror's not perfect, so there are a few scratches. And so some of it does go to your eyes. And so you probably saw there on the video, when I shine the light on the mirror, it got much dimmer. A little bit went to your eyes, and so you still saw it in the mirror, but you didn't see it like the whiteboard, because the whiteboard, as it came down, it would hit, and I'll have to really kind of explain this with a thickness to our beam, because all those ridges would then bounce off and send some light that direction, and some of the light this direction, and some of the light off in this direction, and some of the light back off in this direction. And so when you shine this beam on the whiteboard, which we often refer to as a diffuse reflection, it's really the law of reflection for all the different curvy shapes on the whiteboard. And so when I shine it on here, there's some light going to that student, and some going to that student, and some going to that student. And all the students get it because of this curvy, wavy, rough surface. And so that's why I see it when it hits the whiteboard. But it still is obeying the law of reflection. And so the light that right now is going to the camera is just a small percentage of the light that is actually here. Because again, some light goes that way and 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 that way. And so everybody in this room would be able to see it. And then as soon as I hit then a highly smooth surface here, it would then, most of it would go over to that far wall. And when it goes over to that far wall, only somebody over there would be able to see more light. Everybody else would see less light. So that's referred to as a diffuse reflection. But I can't repeat this enough, because we're going to get into some tricky stuff here, that I explained this with the law of reflection. Everything in this chapter is explained with the law of reflection. And of course, because of the law of reflection, there's also a lot of geometry that comes into play. In fact, I better move along here so that I can help you set up the geometry and not leave you hanging over the weekend, although if that happens, so be it. But let's start here. The simplest case of a mirror will be what we call a flat mirror. A flat mirror, as the name implies, literally is a flat or a plane that reflects the light. And so I've been holding up a kind of a small plane mirror. But over here, I have a big plane mirror. And so here is this big mirror. Maybe I'll just call it a bathroom mirror. It's, you know, whatever these dimensions are. This comes off of an old medicine cabinet. And so here's that medicine cabinet kind of laid on its side here. And so I've got this mirror. So why don't I do this? Why don't I come over here in my drawing and say, all right, I'm going to draw, and I'll just do a vertical line, and say, this is my mirror. And maybe there is something, and I'll just, you know, say this is a bathroom mirror. And so maybe right here is the cap of my toothpaste. And so maybe I took it off and placed it down on the counter. And so the cap is near the mirror. And of course, if I were to look down, and so here I am, I could see the lights coming from the cap, and some light would go to my left eye, and some light would go to my right eye, and I'd say, there's the cap. Maybe I'll use this little rubber piece to represent my cap. So imagine, you know, here I am in the bathroom. I take my